portable memory, the ability to transport information of any medium to and from a destination, is often deemed a trivial technology, yet has contributed more to the development of our world more than any other sole invention. Prior to the widespread adaptation of computer networks and the internet, you would distribute programs, images, songs, and other forms of digital content from your local computer using a portable memory device such as a floppy disk, CD, or USB thumb drive. Yet despite the crucial impact portable memory has on the development of technology, there is shockingly little information online about portable memory when it comes to Redstone. I'm CT5K, and I intend to bring portable memory to the world of Minecraft. Join me, and let's dive in to the design and construction of Redstone Portable Memory. To design a portable memory system in Minecraft, we must first lay out a plan for how our system will work. The solution we will discuss functions very similarly to a CD player. The process starts when a user puts in the input memory unit, which is an item or block that houses all of the digital data as a series of ones and zeros. Our device will then systematically read each bit, decode it to its respective value, and output it to a serial tape. The last thing we need to do for our device is ensure that data can be preserved, so that we can copy and run our code time and time again. While this may sound complicated, as we break it down, we find it to be a rather simple design. Now let's discuss the memory unit. Our memory unit has to meet two requirements. First, the unit must hold bits of data that can be interpreted. Second, it has to be able to change its location. While this sounds super simple, there isn't much in Minecraft that actually meets these two rules. So where can we find a solution to our problem? Introducing the camel flying machine. The Shulker Box is a block that came out all the way back in 1.11. It functions as a single chest, but keeps its contents in order, by the way, whenever the block is mined. So while its memory is rather small at 27 bits, or 3 bytes and some change, this is a perfect candidate for a portable memory system. Now, when the bundle was first introduced, I was really hoping it would be able to replace the Shulker Box due to its size capacity. But alas, the bundle, it's a mess. So for this, I'm just gonna be sticking with the Shulker Box. Now that we have our memory unit, how do we structure the memory? What base do we use? What items dictate a given value? These are really important questions. If one system defines a dirt block as a 1 while another defines it as a 0, then the two devices would inevitably give different outputs. And our reader doesn't automatically know what something means. What does a sword mean? What about a mob head? Are they equal? The device doesn't know. We've not told it what these mean. So we have to make a model that can be standardized and give the same output for any character that meets a specific requirement. We could use item sorters, but that uses a lot of hoppers and can be rather large. And that means we have to have 27 times whatever our base is, because we can't guarantee that nothing is unstackable. This defeats the purpose of an easy to build, easy to use, survival friendly portable memory system. Thankfully, there are a couple properties inside Minecraft that allow us to easily structure the mumbo and jumbo inside our Shulker Box. If you go to the Minecraft wiki, you can find a term called full stack equivalence, or FSE. An item's FSE tells us how much of a full stack that item is. As of this video, Minecraft only has 3 FSE values. Most items stack up to 64, therefore having an FSE of 1. Items such as eggs and ender pearls can only stack up to 16, meaning each one of those items has an FSE of 4. Non-stackable items can't stack on top of each other, giving them an FSE of 64. When a redstone comparator reads a container's state, it reads the total FSE inside the block and outputs a signal based on this chart. So a shulker box with 20 pickaxes will have a higher FSE than a shulker box with 20 diamond blocks. While using an item's FSE value doesn't give us the whole range of hex values possible with signal strength, we can easily do binary and potentially ternary. But for the purposes of this video, we're just gonna stick with binary. To define a zero, we will use any 64 stackable item. Only caveat to this is that each zero has to be a unique item, so that way it doesn't stack on top of each other. But judging by how many items have an FSE of 1, it shouldn't be that hard to find 27 of them. I mean, a single oak log can be turned into 4 of them. So any 64 stackable block serves as a 0. But what can we use for a 1? Introducing the wooden shovel. One of the most useless tools in the game has turned into a secret weapon. Now, we aren't limited to just shovels, as any non-stackable will do, but a single wooden log can be crafted into 2 wooden shovels. And because they are non-stackable, we don't have to worry about them stacking on top of each other. This means that we can use 27 copies of a wooden shovel and data will still be preserved. With this information, here's the basis of our circuit. The user will place the input shulker box here. The hopper below will pull items one at a time from our input block. This comparator will read the FSE value of the item in the hopper. Because a hopper has 5 storage slots, an FSE of 1 outputs the signal strength 1. An FSE of 64 outputs the signal strength 3. We can then define our system so that any signal strength of 1 is deemed a 0, and any signal strength greater than 1 equals a 1. The hopper then puts the item into the output shulker box, and the cycle repeats. Now we have to worry about timing. When designing my prototype, I used a clock connected to a rising edge circuit that prevented the hopper from operating continuously since it was messing up the serial line. But rather than having a clock run continuously whether or not the circuit is being used, it's kind of pointless. So I reconfigured the circuit to stop the clock after the shulker box is empty. So if every bit of storage is used, the device will run until it is empty. If none of the bits are used, then the device won't output anything. If 10 bits are used, the device runs until it is empty. You get the idea. So now, let's get to building this. So we start off with blocks representing our input and output shulker box. We will place a hopper right here, feeding into this output shulker box. We will then place a comparator facing outwards from this hopper. Now, it doesn't matter if this comparator is in comparison mode or subtraction mode. It just matters that it's here. Next, we're going to build an L shape like this and place redstone dust on top of it. This is now our data outline. So when we have a 1, it will place right here. And when we have values greater than 1, it will output right here. Next, we're going to place a target block right here and place a redstone torch. Now this is our lock pin. So when we're dealing with the serial data, this will be connected to a repeater, and this will be what locks the repeater. Next, let's build some circuits to control the output so that way it is not running continuously. Note, there does have to be a target block right here. So now when this is active, the device will not be running. And when it is deactive, it will allow the device to run. Next, let us make this a rising edge. Now it doesn't matter if this repeater is set to 2 ticks, 3 ticks, or 4 ticks. The only thing you have to worry about is that it cannot be 1 tick. Otherwise, this circuit is completely useless. The last step is to add the clock to allow the device to run continuously while this still has items in it. We will start by placing this right here, and then placing another redstone dust right here. Now because of how redstone torches work, this is going to short out the torch. Let us place a block here to fix that. Next, we will place a target block here with a torch on it, and then a block like this with a repeater. This repeater can be set to whatever. Next, we will add this line to connect the clock to our rising edge. Lastly, we will add one repeater here so that the clock can repeat. Lastly, add a button here to allow the device to run in the first place. So now I want to show this device in action. So I've attached a dummy serial output shown in the blue. And then here is a shulker box encoded with a checkerboard pattern of ones and zeros. So as you can see, every wooden shovel denotes a 1, and every 64 stackable block denotes a 0. Now when I come over here and press the button, you can see that the device is working properly and outputting the checker pattern. Since the device is done, if we keep pressing the button, nothing will happen, because this input shulker box is now empty. And as you can see, all the contents of this block have moved into this block. To showcase its effectiveness even better, I've reprogrammed this block to have 2 on, 2 off, 2 on, 2 off, and then it goes back to 1 on, 1 off. And as you can see, when I press the button, The serial output matches the descriptions. We have two on, two off, two on, two off, and then it goes back to one on, one off. See? Nice and easy. So what can you do with this system? Well, if you noticed, I didn't specify what kind of serial tape you were supposed to use. I indicated the data and lock pins, but other than that, I leave it up for your interpretation. That's because this system isn't meant to be fixated to one specific task. One person may use this for creating custom music for a DJ stand. Another may use this for creating user IDs. A third may be using this for storing programs for a futuristic computer. I don't want to clip the wings of creators by saying this is used for this task and only this task. I'm just showing you what is possible and leaving the floor open for you to build something incredible. Even though 27 bits doesn't sound like much, that still gives you 2 to the 27th or over 130 million possible combinations, and that is only if you use binary. This makes the system perfect for a door passcode. Another fun fact is that if you use only one block for zero, then the device automatically becomes single use because the zeros will stack on top of each other. Once the data is read, it gets scrambled and can't be reconstructed. The possibilities with this end where your imagination does. So there is the crash course into portable Redstone memory. If you enjoyed this video, then do leave a like, comment, and subscribe. As always, I'm CT5K, and I'll see you in the next one.